Hey, greetings. This is Brad from the Cheese Shop again. This is the second video on creating a GURPS character. This is actually something where we're going to really start to flesh out the character. And what I wanted to talk about today is I'm also breaking this up into three separate sections. I'm going to break it up into appearance, social background, and wealth and influence. The last two are considered just one thing together. So the first thing is appearance. So this is a part of the character creation process a lot of people kind of gloss over, and it's something that you can really make your character stand out from other characters. As with everything else, it's always a point-based system, so anything that's above normal or will give you some sort of bonuses with your roles or skills that you try to use is going to cost you points, and likewise anything that's a hindrance is going to take points away. So let's start with the appearance. So in GURPS, you can have a specific build. And what a build means is skinny, fat, overweight, obese. As you may realize, this is actually a disadvantage in some respects. And each of them have different point levels. And another section of that disadvantage would be dwarfism and gigantism. And you're asking, so why would those necessarily be disadvantages? A lot of times it does affect, like I said before, like with skill rolls. So to give you, it's like, let's say you made a gigantic character and he's human and he's some sort of, you know, thief type sort of character. And he wants to, you know, he's trying to shadow somebody. Well, obviously he's going to stand out. So that can actually be a problem. Hence, that's why there's a disadvantage for that. Another thing about your appearance is your age. You know, a lot of people I've seen when players make characters, they typically just take, you know, not a really young character, but just kind of not really, pretty closer to middle-aged, depending on, you know, the setting. And they make a character based on, you know, just to start out. But you could also play someone that's considerably older. And so that could actually become a fun process because, you know, in a few years of gaming, you know, in gaming time, you could be rolling for health rolls to see whether or not you contract a disease or, you know, whether or not you have some sort of issues that pop up from being a person of older age. So you can see how these particular disadvantages and even advantages are going to start coming into place. And it's really going to, like I said earlier, just going to flesh out your character and make it more personal and something that you could actually play whenever you role play. Another thing is beauty. And that's just like it sounds. And a normal beauty would be just the 0 points and you're just average appearance. You know, you don't really stand out. But when you start to stand out, depending on how much you stand out on either scale, and this also depends on the setting that you're playing in, is plus or minus points. So, you know, some of the examples of different types of beauty would be, you know, just on one side, hideous, you know, someone that normal people in a specific setting would have adverse reactions to, can't look at, and would just cause a ton of issues to crop up with the person. Like, no one would want to talk to them, no one would want to help them. So you could see how this would be, you know, could be a disadvantage. And of course, on the opposite side of that would be, you know, someone that is extremely beautiful and, you know, could just be a beauty contest and, like, has things done for them. There's just a lot of things. So just to kind of give you an idea, like I said, with the appearance, it is a good thing to actually have. And if, when you first start making your character, you should at least look through it and through the book and at least pick something out of there and to kind of give your character just a little more than just the average, appearance levels. That way you can have something to build on whenever you actually start, when we go through the rest of this character process. Great. Now, so the second thing I'm going to talk about is social background. And some of the things that are entailed in social background are what tech level your character is, and I'll explain that in a second, your culture familiarity, and languages that you speak, write, and, you know, how well you do those particular tasks. So tech level. What does tech level mean? Well, tech level in GURPS stands for technology level, and it's a number that's given to a specific time frame, and some sort of place. And I know that that seems vague, but to give you an idea, on Earth, that where would be tech level 8 in this setting right now? You know, we have Wi-Fi, we have computers, we have, you know, we have vehicles, we have, you know, renewable energy. There's different things that make up a tech level, societal and technology levels, all kinds of things. And everything in GURPS, especially things that require some skills, that like computer programming, has a tech level. So computer programming now would have been a completely different skill than computer programming back whenever computers, you know, were the size of airplanes. You know, just something that was, it's just something totally different. So this is a way for the GM to set a level for his particular campaign or adventure and show you exactly what you can and can't have as far as like specific technology knowledge or skills or equipment. You know, usually that's what most players are looking at, is like, what kind of equipment can I have? You know, can I have that laser pistol now if I'm playing, you know, some sort of spy game? Now, well, probably not, because there are no laser pistols right now, at least not that we know of. So the importance of that is that it does give the players a basis to work with. And there are some games and some adventures where your tech level may be higher. You may know more about a specific skill set or something about, and something tech that is actually more than what the normal people actually have. And of course, that would be an advantage. The Riverworld series, it comes to mind. And it's a place where, you know, once you die, you go to this world where people from all tech levels from Earth and other planets have actually come to live. So there's a varying degree. Now, do you have all of the tools necessary to, you know, possibly make a weapon or to create gunpowder in a medieval fantasy type world? Probably not, but you do know that. So there are some, so this can give you, this adds, like I said, to your social background, the difference in tech levels. The other thing is cultural familiarity. So with that, and I don't really see people take this very often, which is kind of unfortunate, because I mean, it's not something that costs a ton, but it can, like you said, flesh out your character and make it something a little bit more than just average. You know, most people, their cultural familiarity is just their own culture. But it would be interesting to play a character that is familiar with other cultures and could actually interact and interact well, which actually brings to language. So there are people out there that speak many languages, could read, write, you know, and speak them in varying degrees of success. So whenever you buy languages in GURPS, the higher role that you want to have, like I don't speak any French, but if I spoke it, and I spoke it like I had learned it in high school, I probably don't have the accent, I probably sound a little off. That's a different level than someone that went over there for the last few years of their high school or something like that, and they actually learned French and was immersed in the culture, and that added more of an accent, and they grabbed that accent, and then they have it at a better skill level than I would, because I had just learned it in high school or something like that. So language is another thing that you can actually help to make your character a little bit more your own. So just kind of keep that in mind. And also with, as always, with any of these types of things, you need to be talking to the GM about, especially things like tech level. Even if your GM says, hey, we're going to play fantasy. Well, I mean, fantasy is probably tech level 3, maybe 4. But who knows? Maybe the fantasy campaign is going to be set in Victorian England. So you don't know. It's you just need to ask about that, and then you need to find out what different cultures are out there. Anything that you can glean from the GM will help you make your character much better in the actual adventure. Okay, now the third thing that I'm going to talk about is wealth and influence. And if you've ever made any type of role-playing character before, you know wealth is something that can give you more money whenever you first start. You made your character, and it's no difference in there is no difference to that in GURPS. If you can get make your characters very wealthy, it multiplies your starting wealth whenever you at the very beginning. But also, one thing that's different about GURPS is it's because it is a simulationist and it's mirrors realism. You're not just going to start out with just all of that extra, cash or, cool, nice gear. You're going to have to live within those means. That's what's part of being the wealth is. It's not just, okay, I get five times the starting wealth and now I can go out and buy this awesome, set of mail and broadsword, whereas everybody else is walking around with a knife and a club. So just be aware of that whenever you do pick something in wealth that you understand exactly what is entailed with actually each of those different levels of wealth. The other thing is reputation. Now, this is something that's going to come in later through some advantages, disadvantages. And this is something that you really get, something that really helps out your character is backstory. And your reputation, there's three things that are affected here in your reputation. It's your reaction modifier, the number of people that are affected by your reputation, and the frequency that your reputation has. So, if like let's say that you're a mobster in New York, and in the 1940s, and your reaction, everybody in your area is a favorable reaction by people of your same cultural background. The number of people affected are just the neighborhood. You could go to the northern part of the New York. Or you could even go to Chicago and not have the same reputation. So the number of people that are affected affects how many points this would cost, and obviously the frequency as well. So if you're a recluse and you're hardly ever out, then you're not quite recognized as frequently. Whereas if you're always out there on the street corner and you're doing your thing, you're recognized more so. So, and why I say this is important because there are some other advantages and disadvantages that are like reputation, that the point values are always going to be similar because of reaction modifiers, people affected, the frequency. You'll see this in some other advantages as well. And I may even talk about that or write a blog post about describing how to actually flesh out some of that as those numbers for your character. And the last thing, with wealth and influence is your importance in life. There's a couple things that define that as your status and your rank. Now, when I'm talking about rank, it's not necessarily military, police, that those kind of things like a corporal or captain or lieutenant or those types of ranks. This is more just where you rank in society, or even with status, it's where your status is in society. So this is something that as with all of these things in this particular video, you really have to work with the GM and find out exactly what the world is about if you're going to start taking some of these things. And I want you to understand that if you do take any of these types of advantages or disadvantages with appearance and social background or wealth and influence, that you actually do talk to your GM and kind of give them a heads up of what's going on and what you'd like to do. That way you can get the most from your points that you're spending and possibly add more to your backstory. So in closing with this, I just want you to know too that when you start talking about appearance, social background, wealth and influence, that these aren't something that you should just kind of shy away from because to give you an example, with cultural familiarity, that's 1 or 2 points. You're thinking, well, what, 1 or 2 points? I mean, yeah, it's not a lot, but some people don't like to purchase these or spend points either for or get points back for this because they don't believe that it's going to help their character in any way. So, but as you start learning how to play and you start making more characters and you start realizing the complexity and the amazing things that you can do playing the game and making a character, you'll see that you'll start adding these things to your character, and it just won't be someone that's strong and can wield a sword and or can shoot a gun really well. It's you're just not going to be that. You're going to be much more than just things that are written down on your character sheet. And these types of parts of your character are vitally important to making that happen. So hopefully this helped you out a little bit more. The next video I'm going to do is going to be a little bit different. It's still going to be on the character creation. It's going to be about advantages. So I hope this was helpful in some way. And as always, leave comments. And if you can have a chance, visit my website at thecheeseshop.org. Thank you. Bye.